then I use this kind of common prescription to consider some simple case, which I will show you. And then was getting absurd results. And this was the reason why actually when I was leaving Korea urgently because this COVID started, I was puzzled not even so much by COVID, but by this absurd result, which I was getting for the tunneling in the case of false vacuum. But before I will go to the topic of the talk, let me remind very simple problem from quantum mechanics, namely the problem of escape. Unfortunately, on this page, okay, my pencil doesn't work, but it works on the normal transparencies, but you can see. What I have shown on this figure, 2.12, is potential versus coordinate for the particle with 1 degree of freedom, which is moving in the direction Q. And as you see, the potential is unbounded from at large Q. Let's now imagine that we put here a particle in the middle, in the local minimum of the potential. What will happen with this particle? You can write this equation 443 for the wave function for the eigenvalue of the energy of this particle. But of course, it's wrong equation because potential is unbounded. And therefore you could consider the solution of this equation only, and even equation only as approximation for so-called quasi eigenstate value for the energy. But when you will be solving it, then within potential well, of course, you will find normal solution. Psi is proportional exponent and then square root of 2m e minus v dq. It's quasi-classical approximation. Here inside potential well, unfortunately, I cannot draw on this slide for some kind of reason, but okay, it's only one slide. And here you have normal oscillating wave function. Then, but nevertheless, you understand that in this case, particle can escape from the potential way and all go on the right side. And to calculate what will be the probability of escape, what can you do? You can just take this function, which is given by 444, and analytically continue it on the right side. It's not so simple. Okay, it's quasi-classical approximations. They will appear of course phases because here near the turning point, analytical approximation, I mean, quasi-classical approximation is not working, but as you know well, okay, then there appears just some kind of phase shift in the wave function, which is not so relevant. But if you would go under the barrier, then this wave function will become imaginary. And as you see, there will appear this exponent here in 445, okay? And if you take particle precisely in the local well, so at the minimum for E equals zero, then equation 446 give you suppression factor or exponent, which define your suppression of finding particle outside the barrier compared to the particle finding it inside the barrier. You see, so, and this kind of action, square root of two integral, square root of 2m v dq, you could rewrite as an action for the particle moving in the inverted potential. And the motion of the particle, okay, is happening in Euclidean time. Then principle, this exponent minus something, this something happens to be nothing more than just action for the motion from zero to Q in this inverted potential, which is shown on this figure, but as a second picture. You see, then if you square wave function, then you will get the bouncing solution where it's written here instanton, yeah? And What you can use after that, you can write the probability of escape for the particle is proportional to exponent minus S instanton. S instanton is the action calculated on the trajectory for the motion in this inverted potential, right? And appropriate boundary condition is that at when time goes to minus infinity or comes to goes to plus infinity, particle goes from zero, then here is reflected and turned back. Oh, I could use this kind of trick. So this is well-known example from the quantum mechanics, normal quantum mechanics. Now, you could ask question, what will happen in the case when you have potential for two-dimensional motion? For instance, potential like this one is local minimum. Then it's clearly you have to find some kind of trajectory or some kind of way of escaping from this potential here, out, here or here, on which the action is minimal. And then you could expect that in this case, you could apply similar procedure, find some kind of Euclidean solution after making weak rotation, right? And then the probability of escape of the particle with 2 degrees of freedom is equal exponent proportional to exponent minus S, where S is the action on the appropriate trajectory. Now you could consider 3 degrees of freedom. You can consider 10 particles with 30 degrees of freedom. In this case, I cannot just draw potential because I have to draw potential in the dimension of space, which will be 30 plus one at least for 10 particles, each of which is moving in 1 degree of in one direction. In quantum field theory, the situation is much more complicated in this sense, because in quantum field theory, as we know well, we have infinite number of degrees of freedom. And now I am going to the topic of my talk. Yeah, so, and this paper or this work was done in collaboration with Eliezer Rabinovich from Hebrew University and Sorin, who is from Dubna. Yeah. So let's consider field theory, namely scalar field theory, where potential has this form, which is shown. Now it should work. Yeah. Okay, very good. Where potential is shown on this figure. So it's normal potential for the scalar field, okay, which has two minima here. One minima is here and the other minima is here. It's clear that if in the whole space, I will make homogeneous field of value phi zero, strength phi zero, then it doesn't look like vacuum state, which here I normalize on zero, will be stable. Why? Because there is a probability always for the going to this kind of state as a result of tunneling. But what I have to tell you, you should not compare this picture for the tunneling with the previous potential for the tunneling with the previous potential, which I showed you before. And let me explain you why. Because here is potential for the scalar field, but you understand that scalar field is the system with infinite number of degrees of freedom. For instance, you can take scalar field at point x at the moment of time t and write it as phi. Then x you put as an index here and time is here. So you could compare these kind of things with notation, which you know from normal mechanics, qn as a function of t, where n numerates degrees of freedom of the system, generalized coordinate of the system. For instance, for 100 particles in three dimensions, it's actually this I takes value 300. But in the case of the field, the strength of the field plays the role of coordinate, and special index x plays the role of the index which numerates degrees of freedom. You have to understand it very clearly, because in this case it's really problem with infinite number degrees of freedom. And for this kind of potential V, the role of potential energy, which we were considering before in the previous example, plays this functional at the given moment of time. So the whole action for the scalar field could be rewritten as kinetic energy minus potential energy. Here stands integral over d3x, but it's the same thing as summation over index I here, yeah, for infinitely many degrees of freedom, and degree of freedom is in configuration space, it's the strength of the field at each point, minus potential energy. But this potential energy nu is not potential V for the scalar field, but it's, okay, this kind of functional. So it's sum over all degrees of freedom, d3x, and as you understand, this potential energy, therefore, is involving not only V, potential for the scalar field, but also gradient of the scalar field. You see, gradient with respect to special coordinate or with respect to index is also gives also contribution to the potential energy. And if you would draw, for instance, here nu as a function of I do not know q in infinite dimensional space, the tunneling, which is analogous to the tunneling of the particle with 1 degree of freedom, should be considered in this potential nu, Greek, yeah, calligraphic, which would be unbounded from below. Why it's unbounded from below from this potential? It's clear because, for instance, for this state, the total nu for homogeneous field is equal to zero if I normalize V on zero, but for this state, okay, which is below, if field would be homogeneous, then for this configuration, nu would be equal to minus or V minimal, which is negative, okay, multiplied by volume of the space. And volume of the space goes to infinity, therefore it's clear that for this configuration, this potential nu, which plays the role of potential in the case of one particle escape, goes to minus infinity. So it's unbounded, therefore the previous example, I think this potential in previous example, okay, the potential which I have drawn is not this one. There should be drawn the other one, but it's infinite number degrees of freedom. Therefore, what can I do here? You could not write. Now, then you could think that if this vacuum is unstable, then it has to decay perhaps because it can go to the other state. And how it could happen? It could happen only with the formation of some kind of bubbles. Because if you look, what it, you could think, okay, the field could go from here to here in the given region of the space, and the bubble will form. But of course, in this state, total energy nu is equal to zero. Therefore, if bubble will be formed as a result of some barrier transition in this potential nu, Then initial energy was equal to zero, so final energy also should be equal to zero. Namely, okay, this new, which involves gradient term d phi over dx squared plus v, okay, integral should be equal zero to for the final configuration. Originally, we had homogeneous scalar field, as you see, which was in the state of so-called false vacuum at phi zero. So finally, okay, this state will be unstable in this situation, and there will be formed so-called critical bubbles. It was for the first time noticed by Kobzarev, Volosh, and Okun in the paper 74, right? And total of finite energy of this emergent bubble, I mean potential energy, kinetic energy, should be zero at the moment of emergence, but potential energy also should be zero. From this term, which is so-called surface tension in the bubble, will come positive contribution, but from this term, because V minimum is negative here in the vicinity of this so-called true vacuum, there will come compensation for this positive term here. So you see, critical bubble appears when the energy released during this kind of change of the field in the local region is perfectly compensating the surface tension in the bubble. So it's normal picture like in the boiling water. Now, to find the maximum, and then of course this kind of process will be happening with some rate of the transition, and our purpose is to calculate the rate of the transition per unit volume and per unit time. And then you know that this kind of false vacuum will be like boiling water. There will be formed the bubbles as we expect on the symmetry ground, the spherical bubbles, yeah, which will be filled finally by the state of true vacuum, which would correspond to this minima. You see, to this minima. And then as a result of the transition, you will release a lot of energy. Bubble will collide, there will be formed matter, but the state for the scalar field will be finally the state which corresponds to homogeneous scalar field with the strength of phi minimum. So it's clear also perhaps that this kind of transition will be sub-barrier, and you could think that, of course, the configuration of the scalar field, which would make the largest contribution to the transition probability, okay, with this kind of boundary condition at some moment of time, if gradient time was say tau, are the configuration which satisfy, which extremizes the action, this action. And after you go from time t to Euclidean time minus I tau, then there will appear here, okay, k plus this thing, kinetic energy plus potential energy. And you could think that perhaps actually, of course, if you would write plus integral, you would see that if you will take some point, then nearby trajectories are canceling contributions, therefore you are looking in some kind of the point of extremum. And this point of extremum, as you know, is some kind of field configuration which satisfies this equation for the scalar field. And then the problem of the calculation of the decay rate of the vacuum is reduced to the problem of the solving of this equation, which is, as you understand, so tau here is now Euclidean time, because I want to look for sub-barrier tunneling. And okay, here, after I made weak rotation to Euclidean time, the derivative from the potential was replaced to minus derivative of the potential. So you could think also that it's like motion in the inverted potential. And there is this gradient term, Laplacian. So on the symmetry ground, as these guys wrote, I mean, Kobzarev, Voloshin, and Okun, you could expect that the emerging configurations, perhaps solutions of this equation, will be spherically symmetrical, but it still leaves the problem extremely complicated, because in this case it still remains partial differential equation with the boundary condition. One boundary condition is that original field should be in the fake vacuum state, and the other boundary condition that the emergent field configuration like this one should have zero total energy, which consists of the gradient term here and plus potential energy. So, and this problem is still not so easy to treat. And Coleman in, I think, 1977 or maybe 76 has suggested ingenious, really, solution for this problem. He said quite reasonably that perhaps the biggest contribution to the tunneling rate should come from Euclidean configuration with the maximal possible symmetry. And maximal possible symmetry here is not O3, not spherically symmetrical bubble, but maximal possible symmetry is O4 symmetry, where your field depends on time and radial configuration only in this combination. This is maximal admitted symmetry for the solution in this multi-dimensional space, infinite dimensional space, where tunneling is happening. And then you say that one calls these solutions, you take solution where scalar field depends on special coordinate only in the combination R squared plus Euclidean time squared. So it's three-dimensional sphere in four-dimensional space here, and you cannot expect more. In the case when field phi depends on special and time coordinate only in this combination, this partial differential equation, in fact, reduces to the ordinary differential equation, where dot means derivative with respect to time. You see? So the whole problem of the moving in infinitely dimensional space, roughly speaking, problem of solving of very complicated differential equation with this kind of initial boundary condition is reduced now to the one-dimensional problem, or roughly speaking, to the problem of solving this ordinary differential equation, which describe you the motion, roughly speaking, of one particle in time rho, just formally. You understand that rho depends on this r and tau squared. Therefore, it's, for instance, for the given tau, it's some kind of spherically symmetrical configuration of the field in the presence of friction. Okay, this term is friction. Of course, originally we do not have any friction in the theory, but this term appears from the gradient term here. You see? Therefore, this kind of fake triction just taken to the account that we reduced the problem with infinite number degrees of freedom to the problem which looks like motion of 1 degree, motion to 1 degree of freedom, you see, in the presence of the friction. And of course, this is second order differential equation. Therefore, you have to impose either two initial conditions or two boundary conditions. Okay, then one boundary condition we know. Why? Because when, for instance, we go far away from the formed bubble, when tau A goes to infinity, rho also goes to infinity, and outside of the bubble, far away from it, there should be the state of the false vacuum. You see this state here. Therefore, one of the boundary conditions is obvious. Now, what about second boundary condition? You see, Coleman, for some kind of mysterious reason, maybe for simplicity, I will discuss it in more detail after that, decided to impose the second boundary condition in the center of the bubble, because rho equal to zero, if you look definition of rho here, correspond to tau equals zero, and tau equals zero will be the moment when bubble emerges, or the moment when you go from the complex timeline back to Minkowski space, and x equals zero. X equals zero is the center of the bubble. Therefore, okay, if you would like to impose the condition in the center of the bubble, then it looks at the first glance, and in fact, it's really the case, then phi dot should be equal to zero. Why? Look at this term here. If phi dot at rho equals zero would be non-zero, then this term, because it's divided by rho, if phi dot is non-zero, non-zero divided by zero would blow to infinity, and it would mean that either field is infinite or second derivative is infinite here. Yeah, because otherwise you will not satisfy the equation. And therefore, to avoid singularity, Coleman imposed this boundary condition. Now, we have well-posed problem. Okay, the whole problem of the calculation of the transition rate per unit volume, per unit time, for the state of so-called false vacuum via formation of the bubbles is reduced to the solution of the ordinary differential equation with two boundary conditions, then you can calculate for this solution, which will be unambiguous action, Euclidean action, like in previous case, yeah? And in this case, action also, because everything depends just on one variable rho, yeah, is reduced to one dimensional integral. And then you could say, it's natural to say that the false vacuum decay rate per unit volume and per unit time can be estimated as exponent minus S Euclidean on this configuration with this boundary condition. And because it should be per unit volume and per unit time, clear, okay, the things on the dimensional ground should be divided by something with the appropriate dimension, say centimeter in power four, yeah? 1 centimeter per unit time and 3 centimeter cubed per unit volume. And therefore, okay, the only reasonable physical thing which you could write here, perhaps, is the size of the bubble. Doesn't mean whatever does it mean at the moment. Some kind of quantity with this dimension which characterizes the size of the bubble. which depends, of course, on the particular potential, like this one, which we consider on the location of the field phi zero relative to the top of the barrier. No, okay, and to calculate this kind of things exactly is real nightmare, because as we will see, but nevertheless, you can always actually write some kind of estimate. And I don't know, by the way, who calculated this kind of things, because people now spend a lot of time calculating one loop correction to the whole thing. It's a pre-exponential factor, yeah. To this kind of probability of rate, then they appears in front logarithm of the in front determinant of the appropriate second functional derivative of the field on this how it's called extremizing trajectory. But it also doesn't give appropriate number. It's, I think, people are a little bit strange. But Coleman and Carlin showed that if you go to get appropriate factor here with the right dimension, then you have to calculate determinant of the second functional derivative of S, yeah, and divided by appropriate determinant where you excluded four modes, which would correspond to translation in time and translation in three special coordinates. So this number is coming as a ratio of infinite number of eigenvalues to the infinite number of eigenvalues minus four. But anyway, actually, it's better just to take it like this and then write the answer on the dimension ground. Unfortunately, there is no experiment. And now let's apply this approach to obtain troubles with Coleman instanton. At the beginning, what I will do, I will consider very simple potential for the scalar field, which will have false vacuum here on the right side, phi zero, and will behave like lambda plus phi four here. And from here, what I will do, I will draw linear potential. Yeah. For instance, alpha phi with alpha, so minus alpha phi plus alpha phi. And now it's clear that this vacuum must be unstable. And I have to tunnel somewhere here, and then in the center of the bubble, finally, I will go in infinitely deep well. No, maybe on the way I will be lucky and I will need some true vacuum state and will be stabilized here. And now for this potential, let's try to find solution of the equations about which I told you, namely this equation for the particle with the friction term and with these boundary conditions. Now, let's say that I will say that the field phi is vanishing at the moment of time rho equal rho zero, phi is equal zero. So if I am moving here, then phi zero corresponds to the moment when I am crossing this vertical line, okay? Now, okay, this is, of course, peacefully integrable potential. And I can find your solution for phi larger than zero. So in this part where potential is lambda plus phi four. And this solution refers to the region rho larger than rho zero. Rho zero, don't forget that it's the moment when field phi equal to zero crossed, or you can say that it's the size of the bubble. Why? Because field phi starts at phi zero, and then it goes like this one, and then goes to, for instance, this value, if I turn out here. And phi zero is, not phi zero, rho zero precisely corresponds to phi equals zero here. Phi is a function of rho. Therefore, you understand that rho zero you could interpret in some sense as the size of the bar. Then, if I would impose condition that in the past, my state was this fake vacuum state, false vacuum state, I will impose this boundary condition here or here. Here I have drawn the state potential just in the limit when this alpha goes to infinity. Then solution of this equation is unambiguous. At rho larger than rho zero, and this solution looks very simple for lambda phi four potential. Okay, you perhaps those of the people who worked with this kind of instanton know that it looks like what people call Fubini-Lipatov instanton, yeah? And delta here plays the role of the thickness of the bubble wall. You see when I am tunneling in this direction. Then rho zero is still not determined. There is one free constant of integration, and you are not surprised by it because I just used one of the boundary conditions. Now, to determine rho zero, what I will do, I will solve this equation, which I have written here, with this boundary condition at phi smaller than phi zero, at rho in between the center of the bubble and the bubble wall. So inside the bubble, where my potential looks already like this one, you see? And then when I use this boundary condition and solve now very simple equation, because in this case, it will become equation like phi two dot plus three over rho phi dot, and here derivative of linear potential will be lambda is equal to zero. So you see, it's like linear equation with constant term on the right hand side. Okay, very simple equation, and its solution at rho larger than rho zero, smaller than rho zero, has this form. So it's quadratic function of rho. Now, what I can do next, I can claim that at the point rho zero, at this point, the derivative of this potential at rho zero should be equal to the of this solution should be equal to the derivative of this solution at the same point. So I claim that configuration, which I am considering, okay, has no jump in the first derivative. And this allows me to determine this unknown constant of integration rho zero. You see, here for this solution, I took, of course, again, this thing actually came here as rho squared because I took just one solution of this second order differential equation. Second solution, which would be singular, I excluded, but this extra constant of integration was fixed by the condition that at rho equal zero for field phi vanishes. So now when I will equate this to derivative, I am getting the following expression for the size of the bubble, where beta is some kind of ratio of the coupling constant lambda plus and linear potential I wrote in this form on the left side. So lambda minus phi zero cube, phi zero was constant also phi, so it's linear potential. This is coefficient alpha, but I wrote it just to have lambda minus on the dimension ground, also dimensionless, precisely like lambda plus for zero. And this is constant term which corresponds to the height of the barrier. Now look what happens. Now, I got now this expression for the size of the emergent bubble. Rho zero squared is the square size of the emergent bubble in terms of the location of the false vacuum with respect to the top of the barrier and appropriate coupling constant. Okay, which characterize the steepness of the potential here and here, lambda plus and lambda minus. And now let's look what will happen if I will start to make potential steeper, steeper and steeper. So let me take now the case when lambda minus goes to infinity. And then what do I see? I see from this expression the size rho zero of the bubble goes to zero. Action, which is given by this expression when lambda goes to infinity, also goes to zero. Of course, in this case, quasi-classical approximation is breaking, but let's forget about it for a minute. And then the probability of the decay rate of the vacuum in the case of very steep linear potential on the right side. So imagine that you have this steep well just in the mountain, you are here, right? The probability of the transition from this point to down is becoming infinity because probability per unit rate and per unit time is given by one over size of the bubble and power four. And it means that if you stand here, then you immediately should go infinitely deep, okay? And you will not survive here irrespectively how far away you are from this dangerous part or how far away or how high is the top of the potential. Imagine yourself in the mountains, okay? You are somewhere here, very far away from dangerous place. Then it's clear that if on your way here is very top mountains, then you will never fall down. It's even more smaller probability that you will draw infinite tunnel to jump immediately down. But it looks like in the false vacuum, like this one, false vacuum doesn't matter. It's located here, here, or here, or here, or potential well is here, okay, will decay instantaneously just during infinitely short time when this second part of the potential will become 90%, okay, completely steep. How this conclusion sounds to you? It sounds like absurd. Calculations here are elementary. You cannot make mistake, okay, because this solution was obtained in 100 papers, and this solution, okay, even in kindergarten, smart kid will get it in 3 minutes. So, and both of the solutions were obtained as a solution of this Coleman equation, yeah, with appropriate Coleman boundary conditions. So you start to think what is wrong about it, you see? So I told you that when I was leaving Seoul last year, I spent all my time, okay, drinking and thinking about this kind of problem because it doesn't look reasonable. was that? Finally, the solution was found. But before the solution was found, let me say you about one more trouble with common instantons, which also exist forever, but people prefer to forget about it. And this trouble is the following. The absence of common instanton in the case when it obviously should be there. Namely, let's take standard model, okay? But I will reverse the direction of Higgs field here, from left to the right, yeah? And let's say that we are in the state of the false vacuum, where we, I suppose, live today, because for large mass of the top quark, yeah, the potential should be unbounded at the scales above Higgs potential. Effective Higgs potential should be unbounded at the scales above 10 GV, I guess, right now, or 10-9 GV even. In fact, actually, there is no good calculation. I was amazed for the potential of the Higgs field, even in the standard model until now. But we found the most recent reference where, because if actually, if I would lose just, I would use just one loop result, I would get that, okay, potential, Higgs potential for the standard model should be unstable already as the energy is 10^14 GV. TV, not GV, sorry, okay, because the state of the false vacuum is 250 or 350, 250 GV, yeah. And at the state, at the energies which are reached on accelerator, one loop potential would give me maximum, and then dropping down effective potential, like lambda phi 4, yeah. But then people use two loop potential. Okay, forget about this thing. Okay, it's not my problem how they calculate this two loop potential or resum two loop potential. But right now, I want just to discuss the pure situation in this case. So I will take this Higgs potential, which can be approximated in the vicinity of so called false vacuum, where do we live by lambda phi 4 potential, right? And on the other side, when I go to the Planckian energies, here I told you that I reversed the axis, okay? I have minus lambda minus phi 4, or logarithm phi here should be added also to one loop effective potential. For two loop effective potentials, there should be added also phi 4 logarithm squared phi or something like this. But this logarithm doesn't change the conclusion when you have this. And then people start to say, look actually, but if in the standard model, so it's in our world, the potential has this kind of form and we live here, then perhaps we have to worry. And finally, in our universe will be formed some bubbles and all of them will kill us. And let's calculate the probability of the tunneling from this false vacuum to the so-called unbounded part of the potential. And what we have to do is we are applying Coleman approach. We are applying Coleman approach, then we have to solve this simple equation. In fact, it's not so simple because it's non-linear, although it's ordinary differential equation. And it has the first integral, which is like this one, can be written like this one. Now, if I will take now common boundary condition, phi dot at rho equal to zero is equal to zero in the center of the bubble. Then, as you see from this first integral, rho equals zero, phi equals zero, not divergent, then E minus first integral should be zero. And I am getting unique solution of this equation with free constant of integration. And if I would consider this kind of problem, solution of this equation is a problem of the motion of the particle with friction in the inverted potential, it means that here at some moment of time rho zero, I start with zero velocity, but then using this Coleman boundary condition, but then irrespective of the second constant of integration, it look like I never cross the point phi equal to zero and will get to this hill. So we'll never go to the state of the false vacuum. There are no solutions with Coleman boundary conditions which would connect this point to this point, right? So what kind of conclusions you could make in this case? You could say, oh, then if there is no Coleman solution, then maybe the tunneling is happening not according to Coleman, maybe there is some different kind of field configuration, etc. But it's blah, 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 of course, at this point. Second thing, of course, you could make conclusion, but then we are perfectly safe. There is no solution which brings us to the unbounded part of the potential when potential is too steep. On the other side, of course, as a formal conclusion, it sounds okay, but as a conclusion of normal, reasonable guy, it sounds like absurd. Now, when people calculate probability of the vacuum decay in the standard model, what they do, they use so-called Fubini-Lipatov instanton, which describe you the tunneling from the top of this potential down. And by the way, this probability, because lambda phi four theory is scale invariant theory, right? This probability doesn't depend how deep you are here. And also, and then they say, oh, the action in this case will be like minus 8p squared over 3 divided by lambda minus, and lambda minus near the top of the potential is very small. Then we are getting probability of the decay like minus exponent minus 800 or maybe 1200. And then it doesn't matter what is the pre-exponential factor. You can change it from Planckian scale to the size of the universe. Nothing can influence this small number, therefore we are safe. But first of all, who told you that you are tunneling from here? To tunnel from here, you still have to get up here, and there is no solutions which bring you from here to here. I discussed this thing actually with Linde, I discussed it with Schaper-Segal, I told, but come on, okay, for scale invariant potential also, if you write the decay rate like exponent 1/ρ0 in power 4 exponent minus something, yeah? Then there should be something with dimension of rho zero, but for lambda phi four, for Fubini, this kind of thing, yeah? And of course, they agree, but they say this exponent is so small that here, if you cut the thing even by the Planckian scale, this little exponent will not change too much, but it's not the answer, as you understand. And the answer should contain phi zero. Anyway, the location of the false one. So again, situation looks like absurd. And by the way, on this topic, there are thousands of papers where everybody is tunneling from the top of the potential somewhere down instead of taking more easy path, going along classical way. But okay, I'm not responsible for these people. Now, where is the root of the problem? Because my time is nearly over, I will flash you now the main idea and I will present the result, but maybe it's not so bad that I explain you in more details the original problem. And the root of the problem is in fact in Coleman boundary condition. Wait a minute, where is my... No. Okay, five. But there is, okay, this color. Five, okay. Okay, now I can write, yeah. The problem is in the Coleman boundary condition, phi dot at rho equals zero is equal zero. And you understand that rho equals zero corresponds to the moment k, which are going to infinity, yeah? And it's so-called ultra, super, ultra deep, ultraviolet region where we do not know anything in quantum field theory. It's clear that precisely to rho equals zero, you cannot go in any way because there is a natural restriction by Planck scale, for instance, but of course Planck scale has nothing to do with this problem, there will appear the other restriction. And the problem is the following, that Coleman solution is a solution of classical equation of motion, but classical equation of motion, you can trust solution only when strength of the field, classical field, is substantially larger than the amplitude of quantum fluctuations. And let's take the moment of the emergence of the bubble when rho is equal just to the distance from the center of the bubble. And let's look what is the spectrum of vacuum fluctuation, okay, as a function of the distance from the center of the bubble. If you take massless scalar field, then the result is well known. The amplitude of quantum fluctuations, which are present like this one in all scales, yeah. Smaller is scale, larger is fluctuation, and the amplitude, depending on the scale, is dropping down inversely proportional to the scale. And appropriately, the derivative of the amplitude of the quantum fluctuations of the scalar field is dropping down like one divided by rho square or r square or distance square, just take normal derivative. You see, and because field phi itself is not playing too much role because it's shift invariant, more sense makes sense to compare change of the field in the given scale or derivative. And therefore, let's use as a criteria for the importance of quantum fluctuations, the derivative, the derivative of the scalar field. And let's compare the level of quantum fluctuations, which shown here by red, and which, of course, quantum fluctuations go to infinity when rho goes to zero, and they are dropping like one divided by rho square when rho far away from the bubble. And let's compare it with the solution, Coleman solution. And Coleman solution corresponds to phi instanton dot at rho equals zero, therefore it starts here. And of course, it converges to the state of the false vacuum at infinity, therefore phi dot should drop down. Therefore, Coleman instanton is this kind of solution. And it's clear that it can be trusted only where the strength of the field for the instanton is larger than the level of quantum fluctuations. And this is the only part which I have here, okay, is the part between so-called rho UV and rho ER, where the level of quantum fluctuations is equal to the derivative of the field in the instanton, and which determine your ultraviolet and infrared cutoff scale for the classical solution where it's trustable. And of course, this kind of ultraviolet cutoff scale is always larger than rho equal to zero. Moreover, this scale is determined entirely by the particular solution. So it's not quantum scale, it's nothing more. infrared and ultraviolet cutoff scale for the classical Coleman solution are determined by solutions themselves and by the parameters of the problem, you see. And this is the only trustable part of the instanton, and this is the reason why I have all these headaches, you see, because the piece of the instanton VZ rho ultraviolet, okay, is the piece where classical field is completely saturated by quantum fluctuations. 5 more minutes, I will finish, don't afraid that I will go forever, yeah. It's also not in my interest. Okay, ultra-infrared scales, okay, because they will not give us too much trouble, I will not consider. They will be given some correction, but these corrections are at the level of 1 quanta, and I will concentrate on the ultraviolet scale, which is determined by this equation. By the way, infrared scale also the second solution of the same equation. So where I equate the derivative of the classical solution to the level of quantum fluctuation. Let's consider now what is happening in the case of linear potential. In the case of linear potential, when I consider small lambda, so when I will consider, okay, the potential like this one, which is not very steep, then I can calculate infrared cutoff scale. Lambda is much smaller than 1 here, and I can calculate ultraviolet scale. And I see that infrared cutoff scale or the central quantum part of the bubble is deeply inside the bubble because it's, this scale is much smaller than rho zero. And rho zero scale, as you understand, is the size of the bubble. Infrared cutoff scale when lambda goes to zero is far away from the bubble. But if I will consider very steep potential now, lambda minus much larger than one, that one I will get. I will get that my infrared cutoff scale, ultraviolet cutoff scale, forget about infrared, lambda minus becomes larger than the size of the instanton. It means that instanton, Coleman instanton here, is fully saturated by quantum fluctuations. And those instanton which were responsible for this absurd behavior down, yeah, they just not trustable because they are at the level below the level of quantum fluctuations. Now, important thing, now, because we recognize the role of quantum fluctuation, and quantum fluctuation introduce infrared cutoff and ultraviolet cutoff, and when cutoff appear, then you say that, okay, you cannot, like Coleman, go to rho equals zero and formulate this condition with the purpose to avoid singularity, because you are working anyway in non-trustable regions. Therefore, what we do, we just abandon this condition because right now we do not need it. This condition, phi dot equal to zero, we're giving us so-called this possibility to avoid singularity in the center of the bubble, but you know that infinitely close to the center of the bubble, you cannot trust to these singular solutions anyway. And if you abandon this condition, then instead of solution which I had before when there was no term like this one, now there appear extra term which would be singular if I would be able to go to rho equals zero. So the appears with the extra constant of integration. But now I am safe because how my solution would behave if I would start at rho equal infinity. Then it would go here like this one. Then this solution would turn back here, there would be bounce point, and then going through the top of the inverted potential would go to singularity in the center of the bubble, but by the way, at positive rho. But I know that this second part of the solution, when I am returning back and going to singularity, is not trustable, because before I will turn back, there will appear cutoff here. You see? And this cutoff is regulator, which gives me finite action. And as a result, where what I am getting now nice picture, first of all. I am getting, instead of one particular instanton, the whole spectrum of the instantons of different size with the quantum core, as you see here. And this extra parameter is this extra constant of integration, which define me this spectrum of the instanton. And if now I will consider the most troublemaking case, then I see that in principle, if I am considering infinitely steep potential, I cannot go below, roughly speaking, phi zeros fourth here. So it's the maximal deepness at which I can go. And if I go here, then of course my bubble always is bounded by the scale phi zero, therefore phi zero is very relevant scale, and it's quite important at which distance you are here. More far away you are from here, okay, better for you perhaps, right? Over rho one, phi zero. Yeah, maybe worse, but anyway, you cannot go infinitely deeply because there is this bound. And for instance, you can go here and probability of this kind of transition is small because so-called you have to form here, you are gaining not too much energy, and therefore bubble should be very large. Now I'm finished. So you see, we resecure the problem. There is no problem. We took into account quantum fluctuation, and let's look what will happen for quartic potential. 1 minute, just 1 minute. I understand that I perhaps got on the nerves already of the people. Yeah, here the same thing is happening. Here, when I would impose Coleman boundary condition, of course, I would never be able to go from this left side of inverted potential to the right side of inverted potential. But when I abandon common boundary condition, I am getting solutions which are given by the way in distinction from simple Fubini-Lipatov instanton, not like power function, but they are given in terms of the Jacobi elliptic functions, which describe the oscillation in lambda phi 4 potential, you see. It's like sine cosine. And because I am not suppressing them, of course, I have possibility to have transition from left to the right. And of course, the probability of the transition depends on the position of the local vacuum, false vacuum in the standard model. Okay, here are the solutions on which I have no time, to discuss. And here also, you see, I cannot tunnel infinitely deep, for instance, in the standard model, because everything is restricted now by the quantum fluctuations, because this kind of transition is on the border of applicability of semi-classical approach, because it precisely corresponds to one quantum transition. You see here many quantum transitions. Okay, so conclusion. The boundary condition phi dot equal rho, which Coleman suggested for all four instanton, must be abandoned because quantum fluctuation induce ultraviolet cutoff entirely determined by the parameters of the classical solution. This cutoff regularizes the singular solution and thus there appear a new class of non-singular instantons which all contribute to the false vacuum decay. Thank you very much. I finished.
Oh, thank you very much for the interesting talk. Are there questions or comments?
Hello. I had a question about the UV cutoff.
Mm-hmm.
Is it somehow related to the nature of the potential, the inflaton, instanton, the shape of the instanton, or it's a generic UV divergence in a sense that if you just consider a quadratic potential like a harmonic oscillator and just take an integration for with respect to momentum and get a quadratic or logarithmic divergence, it is a kind of the similar kind of divergence.
It's similar kind of divergence, for instance, because the problem somehow can be formulated here is a problem, for instance, in the expanding coordinate, mean coordinate, like cosmological problem, you see. And it's a similar kind of divergences like in cosmology, in this sense. In cosmology, you know that you can regulate these divergences in contracted universe, for instance, by the Planckian scale or whatsoever. But here is a different thing, in a sense that, for instance, for this solution, which we are considering, there is self-regulator, you see, because you just say you are interested not in the future. In cosmology, you are interested in the future evolution of the universe in singularity or after bouncing from the singularity. But here you are interested in the contribution of some kind of path, which is completely okay. Besides that, if you would consider, if you bring it to singularity, then this path would give you divergent contribution to the action. But then on the other hand, you know that there is self-regulator, which cut you. The applicability of the solution give you perfectly finite action, even for those solutions, which if you would integrate without thinking, would give you blowing up contribution. You see, then you say, come on, okay, guys, this kind of trouble which I have from this singular solution, okay, which Coleman excluded with the help of this kind of condition, which for sure should not be applicable, rho equal to zero, then this kind of regulation remove you a lot of troubles. And for instance, lambda phi 4 potential, unbounded potential, lambda phi 8 unbounded potential. There is a whole class of potential. We will write paper, or we will publish some paper where we will show that there is a whole classes of potential where vacuum should be unstable, but there is no Coleman solution. And there is no Coleman solution because of this because of this condition. Zero is equal to zero, which we, okay, so it's moving much more slow. Now it moved, which we impose just with the purpose not to get trouble from the very center of the bubble, you see, because this condition was supposed to take care about the very center of the bubble with the size maybe smaller than the Planckian scale.
Is this divergence a kind of something we can subtract by hand?
No, you don't need to subtract it. You have to cut it because you know the solution is not trustable.
Okay.
In this divergence, you see, you should not integrate over the center of the bubble, the very center of the bubble, when rho goes to zero, because you know that what you are getting instead of that, here you are getting some kind of quantum core where the state of the field is vacuum, normal vacuum, maybe with shifted energy. using this classical solution, you should not trust this. Because its amplitude is always smaller than the amplitude of quantum fluctuations. You see, if, for instance, you would have field like this one, but your quantum fluctuation strength of the field would be like this one, okay? It would not make sense to speak here about the strength of this field. You would not filter it even from under the quantum fluctuations. How you could filter it? You could take charge, and then what have you, how you measure if it would be electric field? Acceleration, but you understand that the amplitude of quantum fluctuation here is much larger.
Right.
Okay.
Hi,
hi,
nice talk. And could you briefly describe the implications of your new solutions to the physics of the phase transition and the bubble nucleation, bubble collision, gravitational wave production, etc.? I mean, qualitatively.
You mean in the presence of gravity or no, or for standard model without gravity?
Yeah, I think we eventually principles, right?
Yes, but you understand that. For instance, if you would consider just standard model without gravity, if I would trust in the result of this calculation of two loop resummed God knows what potential, then conclusion stays unchanged. We can feel very well in our fake vacuum because during next 100 billion years, nothing will happen. Probability is too small, you see, for the standard model. Now, if we are speaking about implication of the whole thing to the gravity, then it's still the field which has to be investigated, you see, because as you have seen, there appeared a lot of headache even in the case when there is no gravity. For instance, for linear potential, by the way, the bubbles are never seen wall bubbles. You see, in many cases, the bubble are not seen wall bubbles. And in spite of the fact that the equation looks stupidly simple, it looks like actually it's very difficult to solve it. Therefore, people are doing it normally with computers, you see, especially when thin wall approximation is not applicable. For thin wall approximation, everything is known, and of course, all the results are presented even in my book on cosmology, but in thin wall approximation, of course, probabilities are always extremely small, you see. Now, how it's applicable to the case when we have de Sitter, anti-de Sitter, what is the role of the gravity? Yes. Hello?
Hello? Yeah, sorry. Please go ahead and go on.
Hello,
yeah, I can hear you.
No, so, but somebody interrupted, what happened?
Sorry, there was a phone call.
Somebody want to add something, sorry. Okay, so the case of gravity is supposed to be still investigated. You see, but there is a lot of things to be done.
Yeah, okay.
So.
Okay, thank you.
It will be separate topic.
Other questions or comments? May I ask you another question?
Yeah, sure.
So, as I understand, you said that this boundary condition phi dot vanishes at rho equal to rho is imposed because of this term 3 over rho times phi dot around the equation. And this 3 in the numerator is the number of spatial dimensions, right?
Yes, absolutely right.
So
3 spatial dimensions.
Yeah, if you go to 0 spatial dimensions,
then there will be no system. But in zero special dimension, as you understand, okay, the problem is reduced to quantum mechanics, because in this case, the field strength depends only on time. You know, it's like in matrix model. I do not know you are aware, you know, when people okay, declare that, oh, they solved everything, reduced quantum field theory to the quantum mechanics, because they considered, roughly speaking, one plus zero dimensional models, which was, of course, nonsense. Yes, there is no friction term. Then the problem is equivalent to the Turner and the quantum mechanics.
Okay, then in that case, these troubles with the Kolmanis-Anton do not exist in the first place.
Right, but the trouble is the space about which you are speaking doesn't exist also. The troubles with Kolmanis-Anton do not exist, but in this case, you do not need even to consider Kolmanis-Anton, because then it's normal quantum mechanical problem which solved even in Landau-Lifshitz, as you understand.
Yes. Okay, yes. Are there other questions or comments?
Sorry, one very naive question.
Please go ahead, right?
Yes. In your first slide, you talked about these one loop corrections to the decay rate.
Yes.
I didn't follow your argument that.
Let me see. You have path integral exponent is, right? Then what you do with this, okay, you have it on classical solution on instanton, plus you consider quantum fluctuation, like, okay, it's second functional derivative, dq, dq, and then delta q, you see, and then what you do, square, and then what you do normally, okay, when you do path integral, you also have to integrate over these fluctuations around classical point. And this second functional derivative normally give you pre-exponential factor. But of course, in the action when everything normalized on H, this pre-exponential factor also is dimensionless. Therefore, people were asking from where dimension is coming. Because you have to write Schrödinger equation for the field configuration, or Tomanaga-Schwinger equation, make the things honestly, but there was again an ingenious guess by Kolman, in the paper by Kolman and Callan, that in fact, to get right dimension, okay, they gave some argument, you have to divide this determinant, which you would get from here after integration, by the other determinant with prime or vice versa, right? Where you excluded four zero modes, which correspond to translation in time and translation in space coordinates. And as you understand, okay, each eigenvalue has dimension like centimeter or inverse centimeter. Therefore, you are getting, after dividing two determinants, you are getting the right dimension in front of this result. I mean, as probability of the decay per unit time per unit volume.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
This was a question, or maybe it was different question.
No, it was the question on how did you subtract that?
Because Yeah. It's actually, you understand that even to solve the problem about one loop corrections in this kind of background, which corresponds to the instanton, is headache, real headache. You understand, yeah? Because you could try to use heat kernel approach or whatsoever, but nevertheless, it's not so simple thing, what I would say. Because normally, if you are familiar with this kind of things, when you are calculating one loop in the external field, then accounting of ultraviolet stuff, because it's local, is not very complicated in the sense that you can make heat kernel method, you can apply heat kernel method, you can use Pauli-Villars regularization as Weinberg did, etc. And then get that there are all these quantum corrections, which for instance, are proportional to the higher powers of the strengths of the fields, right? But here for this given classical configuration, which is spherically symmetrical, you have to expand perhaps in spherical modes. I do not know also. Ultraviolet stuff here is not sufficient. And when ultraviolet stuff is not sufficient and infrared things come in the game, then the thing becomes very, very difficult to treat, yeah? I can just give you example, you can check it. If you will want to calculate one loop contribution to the effective action, but up to second order is strength field, you are getting like curvature multiplied by logarithm of determinant of Laplacian curvature, which already complicated operator, yeah? Because logarithm of Laplacian is, okay, you could define it only in the integral representation. And okay, it's some integral over the exact Green's function. But if you are, would be interested in third order, in curvature, right? Then you can open the paper. There is some paper by Barvinsky, Vilkovitsky, Gusev, and somebody else. Then the action looks horrible. It takes 200 pages just to write action. With all kind of one divided by Green function, okay, acting on one argument, Green function acting on the other argument, etc. Therefore, I think actually the exact calculation of the factor in front, even for concrete potentials, is hopeless thing. You by the way, find a lot of papers. There are thousands of papers. I was surprised. There are thousands of papers on the topic, you see, on the internet. The only problem is that I could not extract too much from this thousand.
Thank you.
You are welcome. Yeah. So.
Okay. Are there further questions or comments?
Okay, if no, don't hesitate to ask stupid questions. Stupid questions you can take out from YouTube. And by the way, also, please take out the beginning of our conversation about COVID from YouTube, because otherwise people will say that I say something politically incorrect now.
Okay, I will remove a stupid question. So.
Not a stupid question, but I yes. With my son that I told him about this formation of galaxies, your work, and he signed something for you. So I don't know if you can see it. So that's the
great
origin of galaxy, and he asked me to, to show it to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Inside the galaxy.
Inside the galaxy, yes.
And they're aliens.
Yes, they're in the planet Earth. Yes.
Great. So, smart guy, you know what is galaxy already. Or you know it way better perhaps than us.
Yes, he wanted to, he's excited about galaxies, and I told him about your work, so he was very excited.
Great, thanks. Nice. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye. It was nice to see you.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.